So we are inclined by about 30 degrees to the Milky Way. The Earth is inclined about 21 degrees to the solar system. So if you are in the southern hemisphere, the center of the galaxy is straight up. Sagittarius A is straight up. For us, it's a little bit to the side. But we know exactly where the center of the galaxy is, and we know there's a huge, massive black hole in there, which you're welcome to ask me about it. It's not part of the discussion today. Okay, so now we want to measure distances. We want to measure distances beyond our galaxy. And here we come to Hubble's major discovery. How are we going to measure distances? There are certain stars, which we call them Cepheid variable stars. They're very large stars. They're 5 to 10 times as massive as the Sun. And those stars, they go from dim to bright to dim to bright to dim to bright. They do it forever and ever. Bright, dim, bright, dim. Okay? And they do this in a cycle. And this cycle can be 5 days, could be 20 days, could be 30 days. But if we look at that star, in 30 days it will be bright, 15 days it will be bright, 15 days it will be dim, 15 days it will be bright, will oscillate this way. It turns out that we can then find out how much light this star emits by knowing that period of the oscillation. Namely, a star that emits more light takes longer between dim and bright. Okay? So we have it dim to bright, and if that takes 10 days, then we know that when the star is brightest, it emits so much light. Okay? So now we can measure exactly how much light the star emits by measuring how long it takes for it to go through the cycle. So if the cycle is 10 days, it emits so much light. If the cycle is 20 days, it emits much more light. Okay? So we know exactly how much light comes from the star.
But that's assuming the intensity.
Sorry?
But that is assuming that the intensity is the same. What if a star, there are two stars, one with a lower intensity of light than another?
No, so that's precisely the point. So we know how much light comes from the star at the star position. Now we measure how much light comes to us. So we know the distance. Because if that star took 5 days to go from dim to bright, and 5 days back, then the period is 10 days. That allows us to tell how much light that star emits. Another star that does it for 20 days will emit more light. So we know how much light the star emits. We know how much light we observe. We can calculate the distance. Just imagine if you had a candle, and you put the candle next to your eye, and it's so bright. You take it to the end of the library, it will be very dim. You will take it further out, it will be even more dim. So you can measure exactly the distance from you to the candle because you know how much light comes from the candle. You know how much light you find. You can measure the distance. Okay? So this is the calibration curve. The period of this oscillation allows us to tell, the word that we use is luminosity. Comes from Latin, lumen. So if the star has a certain period, it has a certain luminosity. And this is the curve that allows us to do that. We compare the luminosity that we observe on Earth with the luminosity that should come from the star, and we measure distances. Is this all clear? There's just a little bit of math. Is it okay?
That's using Hubble or not using Hubble?
Ah, this is before Hubble, and here comes our hero. Okay? Thank you for your question. Now let me see if I can move this guy. This is before Hubble. This is Henrietta Leavitt. If there was no Henrietta Leavitt, there would be no Hubble. Hubble will be another Moshe Gai. Nobody would ever hear about him. That calibration curve that I showed you, this calibration curve that I showed you, was discovered by Henrietta Leavitt. She meticulously looked at 2,400 stars, Cepheid variable star, and made that calibration curve. This calibration curve was made by Henrietta Leavitt. Henrietta Leavitt was a deaf woman. Harvard thought, well, she's just a woman. We'll give her a desk. We'll put her in the corridor, you know. Remember, this is the beginning of the century. I don't think women even could vote at that time in this country, right? Right? So she sat over there. She couldn't communicate because she was deaf, but she did meticulous work. 2,400 variable stars that she puts in a table, and she found this calibration curve. Now, there is an interesting story over here. You see, over here we talk about magnitude. I'm not talking about luminosity. I'm not talking about what is magnitude. Okay, in order to discuss magnitude, we have to go back 2,500 years ago. We have to go back to Aristotle. If you recall, the Greek thought that the Earth is in the center. Then the Sun evolves around the Earth. Then comes the Moon. Then they classified all the stars. The brightest star they call 1. The dimmest star they call 6. Remember, the Greek didn't know about the 0. The 0 was introduced by the Muslim. After Salah ad-Din conquered Richard the Lionheart in the famous battle, the Battle of Arbel, near the Sea of Galilee in Israel, the Muslim conquered all of Southern Europe, Spain, etc. They brought a lot of cultural things for us. For example, the oud, which later came the violin. And they introduced the 0. Up until the Muslim conquered that time the Western world, we didn't know about the 0. And Aristotle classified star not starting from 0, starting from 1. Brightest star is 1. Weakest star is 6. Today, 2,500 years later, we astronomers use the same units that Aristotle used. This is why I tell my colleagues, you are the second oldest profession in the world. Magnitude will come back to haunt us. Magnitude tells us how bright is the star. So again, we go back. This is how bright the star is. This is the period of the oscillation. We measure the period of the oscillation. That's very simple. We follow the star every night. We measure it. We know the period. We know how bright it is. We know how bright it is in our telescope. We measure a distance. All of this was possible because of Henrietta Leavitt. Incredible, incredible work. Why all of this is important? Let's go back to the 19th century, 18th century. Astronomers at that time were interested in one thing. They were interested in comets. They wanted to discover one comet after the other. And of course, the most famous one is Halley's Comet. Before we knew that Halley was a special object in the sky, we knew that something is going to happen when Halley's Comet arrived. For example, Jerusalem was destroyed 3 years after Halley's Comet arrived, 65, 68. Chinese thought that the emperor would die when this comet arrived. They always knew that this object that comes every 76 years comes from the heaven to tell us that something will happen. So they kept record of it. For example, Mark Twain was born in 1835 and died in 1910. He came with Halley and he left with Halley. Okay? So this Halley's comet, people knew there's something interesting about it, so they kept record. And the Chinese went all the way to 1000 before Christ, BC. Imagine, King David was out there doing all his hanky-panky with all the girls, and they were looking at Halley's comet. Okay? 1000 BC. Okay? Well, there is one very interesting point over here, that in the year, in the year 1687, Philosophia Naturalis Principia Mathematica was published by Isaac Newton. And he gave us the theory of gravity. Halley said, now wait a minute, that object that everybody was classifying that comes up every 75 years. By the way, did you see it when it was here in 1986? I saw it from my backyard. We got up at 5 o'clock in the morning and there was this little thing in the sky. You had to go to the southern hemisphere to see it, okay? Anyhow, Halley said, how about if I use Newton's law of gravity and I calculate the orbit of this object? So the orbit of the Earth is very simple. It's almost a perfect circle. The Earth goes 1 year around the Sun. Halley's has a very eccentric orbit. And that orbit goes 76 years. Takes 76 years. So Halley's calculated this based on Principia Mathematica of Newton, the law of gravity. And he predicted that between April and September 1759, that comet will return. Halley didn't leave to see the comet. September 15, the comet didn't arrive. So everybody said, Newton's law of gravity is wrong. September 16, 1759, a day after his prediction expired, Harvard astronomers saw the comet. Yale telescope was out for repair. God knows what was there to repair. It's just two tubes. I could take them apart and put them together, okay? And then there were 2 weeks of clouds. And after 2 weeks, they confirmed the observation of the Harvard astronomer, and this is why we have Newton's law of gravity. Okay? Because of Halley's comet. Halley's predicted that all this object that were classified historically were one object that simply came every 75 years. So at that time, everybody was interested in looking at comets. How do you look at comets? Comet moves through the sky very fast. So if you take a picture, the stars are standing still. So they come very bright and in focus. The comet, because they're moving, they're fuzzy object. But they knew that there are fuzzy object in the sky. So they said, God forbid, we're going to look at that fuzzy object and we'll discover a comet. But in fact, it is not. It's something that we actually know. It's called nebulas. So Messier decided, let me catalog all these nebulas, which we know are still existing in the sky, totally stable. And if you look at them, look to the other side. They're not interesting. They're not comets. So for example, the Messier catalog, the first one, M1, is a Crab Nebula, a very famous nebula. What Hubble did, he decided to look at one of these uninteresting nebula. In fact, he didn't look at M31, he looked at the sister galaxy M31, the galaxy in Andromeda. So the constellation Andromeda harbors a galaxy, it's about 3 degrees in the sky, you can see it beautifully in the naked eye. Whoops. And he looked at one of these stars. The stars that go bright, dim, bright, dim. One of the Cepheid variable stars. He used that star to measure the distance to the M31, the Andromeda galaxy. Okay? He never had a picture like that. Not such a beautiful. This is Hubble picture.